Hello there, my name is Pastor Buck Wilford. I'm the pastor here at Brunswick Community Church. We're located right in the Rito's Bakery Plaza at 1930 Pearl Road. We have church at 10 a.m. on Sundays and Bible study at 6:30 p.m. on Thursdays. We also have good Christian education hour at 9 a.m. Sundays if you want to come a little early. We're a church that loves people and we love God. We'd love to connect with you. We'd love to meet you. We'd love to just be a part of your life as well too. We're focused in on preaching the Bible. I do it verse by verse, expository style. We hold to the five solas. We believe strongly that we're saved only by grace alone, through faith alone, through Christ alone. And it's all to the glory of God alone. And the only thing we hold as infallible and inerrant and strongly adhere to is the scriptures alone. We'd love to see you out here. We'd love to have you come visit. Thank you so much.
My God, I'll break the wine. sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Hallelujah. Amen. All right, let's go to 407. 407.
It is well, it is well.
number? Maya, do you know the number?
Go back to 5.
174. 174. What is it called, Maya? That is right.
Continuing our trek through the parables, we have a great parable today, not because I wrote it or can speak on it really well, but it's the Word of God. Today we'll be continuing. Jesus was asked questions from his disciples, and once again, Peter here in The Unforgiving Servant in Matthew 18, 21 through 35. Peter's asking even more questions, and these questions come up because Jesus, our Lord and Savior, is demonstrating God's mercy, His grace, and trying to overcast this Jewish current law with the Pharisees about works-based salvation and all these kind of things. And there's a couple of verses in this parable where people would be like, oh, see, it's work-based. No, 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 you're not getting it in context if you captured that, and we'll highlight that. So I'll begin reading parable 10, and you can follow along if you have your Bible in Matthew 18, 21 through 35. Then Peter came up and said to him, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me, and I forgive him? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you 7 times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle one who was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. And since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife and children and all they had, and payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the master of the servant released him and forgave him the debt. But when the same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. and seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, "Pay what you owe." So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." He refused and went and put him in prison until he could pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then his master summoned him and said to him, "You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me, and should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant?" I can't English today, my apologies. "As I had mercy on you." And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. Dear Heavenly Father, I just ask you to be with us, guide us, help clarify your word, and be with us as we study this parable, Lord. Open our ears, open our minds, and open our hearts to the study of this parable today. I just thank you for this blessed day, Lord. Thank you for everyone that's here. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, the famous question here. How often will my brother sin against me? We probably ask this ourselves our times. And he even said, as many as seven times. And then there's the shocking answer here. Literally up to 70 times seven, or 77 times in verse 22. So if you look at it, seven times, we can go into these numbers and their references and what they mean, but we'll probably get sidetracked and not even finish this parable today. But the construct of 77, what you're taking here, is completeness. Peter asked seven. If you take 7 by 10, that's 70, right? So that's a complete whole number, if we can do math correct. And Jesus is adding 7 more, signifying an infinity amount of times. And the numbers symbolize the completeness. And essentially, his answer to Peter is completeness times completeness plus completeness. Like I said, it's an infinity. God's definition of forgiveness cannot be limited. We might think, well, 77 is a complete number. It's 77 times, 78. No, that's not what the case is right here. He's just trying to allude to, hey, if you would not normally do math that way back then, you kept it, you know, think about the European metric system. Everything's in tens, right? It's easier. He's adding that extra 7 just to throw it out there to be like, 77 times. Why? It doesn't make sense to add 7 more random numbers in there. So there's this infinite amount of time, and forgiveness cannot be limited. So when we think about this story, it's understandable to listeners. A king has a right to gather his servants on any time they want to discuss any kind of matter. And then you have this servant who owed a lot of money. And so I was trying to look it up, minus the current economic situation. These 10,000 talents, I think Jesus used these variables of money to show significance. You see a lot of time with debt, like 500 denarii to 50 denarii. We always see this difference in amount of money because we can think that way. The human eye, the human mind, we can see that, we can read it, we can hear it, and we're like, oh, I can see the significance here. So to put it in perspective, 10,000 talents would be nearly $1 million in today's terms. Probably a little bit more for the last 2.5 years, but let's not get Bidenomics onto this in our current state of our economy. That's not what we're here. So what an outrageous amount of debt. So now if we read back and we think about that parable that Jesus is saying, you're like, wow, that king forgave a lot. And what is Christ trying to demonstrate here? God can forgive any amount of debt at any appointed time. So is the king. The king can call anybody. The king is God here, God the Father. This is what the king is representing, God the Father. God can call any one of us at any time and forgive, no matter how much debt you owe. And we should praise God for that, because I've had a lot of debt in my life. So he had this insurmountable amount of debt, and it's obvious that he could not pay, and he deserved his price to be in prison, as the king so ordered. But he wasn't, and the story takes an unexpected turn. You know, like we were talking a few weeks ago about debt. We don't sit there and go, call up and be like, hey, I'm having a hard time paying right now. They might extend it. They'll keep adding some interest. They'll lower your payment so you pay even longer. But you don't call up to your mortgage company and go, hey, I'm having a hard time. And they'll be like, hey, no, don't worry. We'll forget the debt, right? That would be amazing. And I keep on saying, if you find a place like that, I'll switch my loan to your bank and I'll give them a call. But we also talked, when we were talking about the crowded woman at the end of Luke 7, during the sermon, we talked about debt and forgiveness. And just like the draw back onto that. And that's why maybe sometimes I get upset with the student loan forgiveness thing. Remember, the debt is not forgiven in a sense. Like, it transfers to somebody. Whoever owns the debt still has it, right? The bill lent me $20, and I came up and like, oh, I can't pay this week. And he's like, oh, don't worry about it. The $20 doesn't disappear. Now, bill is taken on that $20. Hey, I'm taking that as a loss. That's why I get upset maybe with student loan repayments. Somebody else is trying to forgive the debts, but you and I are the ones that have to pay that debt, right? So we're not the master, per se. Somebody that doesn't actually have control of the money is trying to forgive it without, you know, trying to get it passed correctly. But I'm getting off base again. But just that symbology of forgiving debt, let's not forget that. It doesn't go anywhere. The person who's taking it is taking upon us. Christ died for our sins. He's bearing that sin. The sin didn't go away. He's just bearing it. So before we go on, let's highlight some of the characters in this story. The king, we probably have discussed that already. It's God the Father who rules over his people. We can probably see that correlation in this story. And the servants, all the servants, are the people who profess to be God's people. And the difference between the two debts in the story, one is unpayable unless you're completely rich. The debt is clearly impossible to pay, and the second debt was extremely small in comparison. You're talking about talents versus denarii. I think we covered that quite a bit. A denarii was a day's wage for a wage worker. So 100 denarii would be maybe 4 months, maybe 5 months of salary. Something that could be worked off in a normal amount of time, like maybe having a small credit card, or you go get need a new fridge from Lowe's or Home Depot or whatever. Something that can be paid off in a short amount of time, as long as you're managing everything well. So what we can take from this, our sins, our debt, are so large, it is impossible for us to work and pay them off. The sins that people commit against us are much smaller in comparison. So you can get that only God the Father and Christ bearing our sins on the cross can forgive our own debts. And we need to forgive our brothers, forgive others for things that they commit against us. It's very easy to get in that trap. Somebody supposed to be working on a project with you at work and they don't do their part. It's easy. Even thinking of it, we're mad, we're upset, we're getting frustrated, we're sinning. But we need to forgive them of that. And that's what makes us not greater than anything else, but makes us, you know, follow that commandment to love our neighbor, right? We should forgive them, give them a chance, encourage them, ask for assistance. And the forgiveness comes from us asking for the forgiveness, and we're forgiving them. We shouldn't expect it from them. So now we'll break this down, called the action, maybe in three acts. Excuse me. Anybody got any questions? Pat's back there. Pat, you got any questions? All right. So the first act, I'll call it the first act, in verse 26, the servant begs for mercy. But notice what he doesn't ask for. He didn't ask for his debt to be forgiven. He just asked for mercy. He said, give me more time, more time. Don't we wish we all had more time? We don't know. Every day, I think we're getting closer. We can imagine that. But for God to bear our sins, to be forgiven, we don't know how much more time we actually have. We do not know the end time. But he didn't ask for the debt to be forgiven. He just begged for mercy. He pleaded, and he asked, and he asked, and he thought he could still pay the sum of his money on his own accord. I can work this off. His debt is so immeasurable compared to the 100 denarii. Maybe he's thinking to himself, hey, I can pay this off. Remember, Peter at the beginning is asking these questions. You know, how many times should I continue to forgive? He's continually telling his disciples and his servants, like we did in the last one, that it's not a works-based salvation. There is nothing you and I can do to relieve this debt. And then we see the king is compassionate, merciful, forgiving of his debt. And we keep on saying it in our sermons, Pastor Buck, myself, others, this unmerited grace that the king bestowed upon him, and then what Christ and our Father bestows upon us. And what you can draw from this first act is that still today we see it, people think they can gain the salvation on their own. And this is what Christ is trying to explain. You can't do it on your own. It took the king to go, hey, I forgive you of these debts. And then it takes another turn, right? Act two, the servant becomes the master, I'll put in quotations, and demands his money from another servant in verse 28. And then the second servant begs for mercy, but receives none. Almost similar languages in there. Begging for mercy, give me time, I can pay this off. But the master, the new master, the previous servant who had this large sum forgiven from him, did not grant the same mercy. Such a lower sum, and we already talked about it. $1 million versus a couple of $100s, or maybe $1,000, is much more manageable. Probably could work it off. And what did he do? He had him thrown in jail. I don't know about you, but that doesn't make a lot of sense, to throw somebody in jail that owes you money. How are they going to pay it off? I mean, there's things called restitution with time served, but they still end up paying some kind of money, right? How is this guy going to pay this debt if you're throwing him in jail? The story is crumbling by the second. How are we going to get the money that we owe? How are we going to pay that debt if we're behind bars? So he's refusing to give others demonstrates the lack of understanding our forgiveness in Christ. So, you know, we talk about at times, and this is where you can maybe draw, and this is where people are going to go, and they're going to see, or they're going to say, see, I told you, you can lose your salvation. Did this servant actually receive salvation? Was he just begging for mercy because he just wanted to be relieved of the debt and one more time? Notice he didn't ask for forgiveness or the grace. He just asked for more time, thinking he can work it on his own. So Christ is telling here, look, he never became part of the covenant of God. He's not elect. He's not chosen. The king, however, graciously forgave him, but he turned right around and did not do the same grace and mercy. He's just as lost as you and I were before we became salvation. So he refused to forgive others and did not learn the lesson he was just given. He is just as far apart as Christ before he was called into that room and the king to plead for mercy. In the next action in the 3 acts, the witnesses report the unforgiveness to the king in verse 31. The king, out of his righteous anger, puts the debt back on the unforgiving servant, 32 to 34. Why? He puts him back in the jail. And the witnesses, and I don't look at it as like snitches, but these witnesses go back to the king and say, hey, you just gave this sum of money, and here it goes. He's putting somebody else in the jail. The jailer's probably gave word. The king is upset. He goes, did you not learn anything from me? I forgave some debt, 100 denarii. You're debt free. So now you're just turning around and trying to get what little money you can. It makes no sense. Like, begin anew. You know, as soon as you pay something off, what's the worst thing to do? Go get another car and some more debt, right? We're not learning. We spent 6 years paying off this car, and I'm like, well, that shiny new one looks nice. Let me go get it. I learned nothing. I'm not saying you can't go get a nice car and have nice things, or loans aren't bad at times, but the moral of the story is I didn't give time to recuperate some money and maybe learn from my mistake and like, oh, let me save up and pay a little more so I don't have to pay someone. So he puts him back into jail once again and puts the debt back on him. And as we know, he's in jail. He might be working his time off in jail in a sense, but the king is still not going to get this 10,000 talents back at all. He's going to be lost. This servant is not going to be able to ever work this off on his own. He's going to be in jail most of his life, or in indentured to this king forever, and never going to be able to out of his debt. And what is he trying to do? Just get a hundred denarii back. Seems like a waste. He fully expected the servant to be as forgiving as others, but that did not occur. The king was trying to show mercy, grace, and teach his servants, but this other servant wanted to become the master now because he held the debt, right? Instead of forgiving the debt, he just went back and says, like, sorry, tough luck. Give me meal. To think about it, that's why I paused for him and I read it again. He choked him out. Like, what love is there? You just got $1 million rewarded. And I'm going to go up to Ted and like, hey, where's my 100? And start choking you out. Like, you should be like running, sharing the good news and be like, the king forgave my debts. Maybe he'll forgive yours. The king is merciful, right? The king can do whatever he wants, right? The king could have put him in jail, had him killed, sold him to try to ascertain some of the 10,000 talents, but that didn't happen. And what we can say here is God requires his people to forgive others. And there's the dangerous thing. Some might take that parable and be like, look, the servant lost his salvation. No, he never had it. He didn't recognize it. He didn't become a believer. He didn't get the joy and the grace and the mercy. He didn't listen to any of that. He went right back and was like, you owe me the money. Give it to me. He was just still far apart. He never had the salvation. And that's what the parable is leaning towards, that God can forgive any amount of debt. And you need to, part of it is to forgive others. It's difficult sometimes. I know a guy almost cut me off the other day coming home from work. You know, either he was going to buy me a new car or my whole right side of the car. And I was really, really upset. I'm like, oh, can't you just see the track slow down? You're like, you know, but now he's trying to pass me faster and then cuss me off. I was upset and I had to come back and stop and go, Lord, please forgive me. And I forgive him. Maybe he didn't see it and that was the best thing he can do. Who knows? By your grace and mercy, we're all alive. Nothing's hurt, so why should I be this upset? It's Friday, and I'm going home to spend some time with my family, and that should be my focus. It's hard when people trespass us, but we need to forgive them. It's not being soft or turning, you know, not defending ourselves. I think we covered that quite a bit. It's just to forgive them. I'm not forgetting the debt, right? I'm not forgetting what you said to me, but I'm forgiving you. And just like Christ, he's not forgetting the sins. He forgave the sins, right? He forgave them and continues to forgive them. He's not forgetting them. He's wearing them for us. He took those sins for us. He's bearing them. Those are among him. He's bearing those sins, just like the king. He's bearing the debt. Anytime you lend some money, and you expect to maybe get it back, and if you don't, and you're like, hey, don't worry about it, that debt did not go anywhere. You're just now assuming it. The debt goes nowhere. And what we can say, God is a God of mercy. Thank God for that, right? But I don't think we deserve any of the mercy or forgiveness he gives us, but I am thankful and I praise the Lord for it. Why would his people lack mercy for other people? That's what we were trying to take from here, right? If the servant understood this grace and mercy, he should have came to the new servant when he ran in. So he goes, hey, I know you owe me $100. Hey, try to get it if you can, but don't worry about it, right? That might have been a new believer, you know, because we could kiss it here. Maybe he was a new believer right here, and then he just didn't totally get it, but he's like, hey, no patience. I'm going to go out and celebrate because I don't have this 10,000 talent over me. No, he went to go choke old poor Ted out. I'm sorry, Ted. It's not worth it for $100, right? Not worth it at all. So that is the king, the servants, and the debt. Do we have any questions? The next one's a kind of a short one with the two sons. I know Pastor Buck missed most of that. I just highlighted quickly that some will take that the right space salvation and be like, see, look, you lost your salvation. They totally misunderstood the story. I actually had somebody debate that with me before, and I'm like, you're missing it. He never came to Christ. He immediately turned around, demanded more money. He learned nothing. He was just as far, and it ends. It ends in 35, so my Heavenly Father will do everything one of you to you. You do not forgive your brother from your heart. The servant never forgave the other servant from his heart and became the master. Instead of being the master of forgiveness and mercy and grace, he just wanted what it was his. He learned nothing, so, you know, he got those false converts. You know, I bet you when the king says your debt was forgiven, it was probably like a lottery winner. Thank you, king. Praised him. Hailed him, and then as soon as he walked out of the room, he's like,
hey, where's my money? Where's my money? You know, he's trying to get ahead instead of being the same gracious host as that king, and we can't fall into that trap.
I think with that thing, like you said, someone tried to say it's an example of people losing their salvation, is it could come from two different perspectives. Is somebody who's all works-based, or somebody who is entirely cheap grace, you know, because cheap grace would say that once you're forgiven, you could care less about anything, you don't have to learn any lessons, you don't have to be disciplined, you don't have to be discipled, there's no sanctification, that'd be cheap grace, and somebody that's on the side of cheap grace may try to angle that thing like that, but then also, the other side is somebody's on the workspace level could try to angle it like that and also forget that throughout the Bible we have all these lessons to learn, like this lesson right there, the way we should be. Sometimes we might fail, but ultimately as a believer, God's gonna teach us, he's gonna lead us, he's gonna see that we get corrected. Might not be right the first time, but hopefully second, third time. And a story like that is the perfect picture of the lost person, the unbeliever, who is trying to make it there by works. You know, he's good with his own self, and who cares about the other guy? And then he realizes he was never there with his own good self to begin with right there. You know, it was a false conversion at best. but a good life lesson for us.
So I think it's right there. When he pleaded for mercy, like it highlighted, he didn't ask for forgiveness. He was just asking for more time, like we highlighted. Yeah, I can still do this, because I explained 10,000 talents, probably about $1 million. There's no way I can't pay that off in my lifetime and still pay for my house and everything. Like, you're just going to be under the shadow of this master, and you're going to just be working for them. You're putting your works, all your hard efforts, just trying to pay this debt off without having the freedom, per se, to, you know, follow and be obedient to God. You're putting everything towards the money that you owe and whoever holds that debt over you. That's not saying owning a home and all that kind of stuff's bad and a debt. It's just the reference of once it's paid off, who are you following? Are you forgiving others? If you're merciful and somebody said, hey, you're good, your loan's good. I mean, I had a house for sale in Ohio when I was recruiting. And that was when the market crashed. And I had to move, and I'm like, how am I going to afford a house here, a house over there? I was a brand new star first class. I'm like, I have a young daughter and a young son now. I'm like, oh my gosh, the pressure of owning this house, how I'm going to sell it. And I was able to sell it at a lower cost, and the bank said, hey, we're good to go. It didn't hurt my credit or anything, but that was the same picture. The mortgage company said, hey, we're good with the amount that we got, and we understand your situation. Thank you. Thank you. You know what I did? Instead of buying another house, I rented. Because I'm like, hey, I learned my lesson. I'm going to wait till I figure this out. It was my first home. I'm going to go rent or live on base. You know, I learned my mistake. Woo! I don't owe anything. They could have turned back and said, hey, we take it at that value. The person bought it got a good deal, right? But you're still going to owe us the difference from the payment. So instead of owing $125,000 left on the loan, you're going to only pay the difference of $25,000. Still have been very thankful, but they forgave it all, and I was able to go off a clean slate and restart, and I'm very thankful for that. And that's a good picture to take. And I was probably a lot further along our way than I was now, but that was probably the closest thing in my life where that kind of debt was like, hey, that was beyond your control. We understand your situation. I mean, I wrote this letter like, hey, if I got to pay whatever, we're trying to get the highest amount. I'm just thankful the house is sold. I don't have the stress, so if I have to pay a little bit, you know, thankfully I'm in the military and they can still put me in a house. And I'm thankful, and I'm going to learn my lesson. Probably not buy a house again until I know I'm going to settle there. Because this is dangerous, because I don't know. Sometimes what, we move after 2-3 years? Like, that's not a lot of time to get in a house and build any equity.
That's a great point on that works-based salvation, that people think that they can somehow pay it off or get there. But if they look at their lives, that $1 million, soon they'd fall into some other thing and have to owe more money. And they would never come to the end of it. Nobody can ever get saved by the works-based salvation method right there. That's a great example to turn around and show the fellow trying to argue the other way.
Yeah. Or
think that guy could ever make that? What else is going to happen in his life, you know?
You know, you got a due date and they're after you, so you go get a credit card, pay off another credit card, right? You're just transferring one debt to a new guy. And you're like, oh, that one's good, they're off my back, but now I still owe this one, and I got some more time. And I'm gonna do it. You're probably gonna have to pay even more in interest, right? You'll never be able to do this on your own. And we're thankful for God's unmerited grace towards us. And I don't know what I deserved it, but I praise God and I thank God that He forgave my sins. It's a beautiful thing. And I wasn't even perfect, you know? Like, I came to Christ as a young teenager, you know, middle-aged teenager. I went back and forth for a while. I didn't deserve any of that, but he forgave me. And I'm thankful, and he allowed me to stay back, and I came back, so I know I'm not the servant that, you know, responded in false pretense and went away. And you know, I hope many of us here, you know, I still, today, thank you, God, for forgiving me of my sins. Like, it's okay to continually to ask, just like the young the woman in the crowd, she has been forgiven. It's a continuous thing, and I think even though we are saved, you know, by grace and faith alone, it's okay to continually to ask for those forgiveness, because we still continue to sin. He forgave us, but hey, I'm just paying my respects and saying, hey, I did something wrong today, help me. I still need to grow. And that's not what the servant did that day. He went straight to violence, not loving his neighbor, and choked him out. That wouldn't be very kind at all. So the next one's kind of short. It's four. You could probably get it in 20 minutes. So it's the parable of two sons found in Matthew 21, and it's four verses 28-32. We're changing shifts. The last couple of parables were towards his disciples, and now he's using to direct other people, maybe aimed at the chief priests, the Pharisees, and all those. So when you're thinking about that, these parables have a new audience. What do you think? A man has two sons, and he went to the first and said, son, go back and work in the vineyard today. And he answered, I will not. But afterward, he changed his mind and went. And he went to the younger son, and said the same. And he answered, I go, sir, but did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said the first. Jesus said to them, truly, I say to you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes go into the kingdom of God before you. For John came to you in the way of the righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even when you saw it, you did not afterward change your mind and believe him. Once again, Jesus is being confrontational and throwing it back into the Pharisees' face, because they're always attacking him for being associated with these tax collectors and eating with them. But we talked. Jesus, throughout his ministry, his walk, he sat, ate, and talked to everyone. They just couldn't take the log out of their own eye. So right before that, to put in context, Jesus was confronted by some of the religious leaders. They asked Jesus, by whose authority do you do these things? He answered them by asking a question of his own, the baptism of John, where it was from heaven or earth. The chief priests and elders were stuck, so they didn't answer, if you think back, right before this. Since they didn't answer, Jesus rebuked them by refusing to declare his authority. Then he told the parable of the two sons. And now notice how personal it is, especially in the latter couple of verses. So he had two sons. He told the first son to go work in the vineyard, and the son was like, no, I won't go. Happens all the time. Hey, Eli. I wish he was here. Hey, I need some help clearing these woods. No. But eventually he comes out. Maybe he gets rewarded. Maybe he goes, oh, Dad's paid me before, a little extra allowance. Or maybe Mom yells at him, get outside and help your son. Or help your dad. I don't know what it is, but he comes out and eventually helps. He even said it with a no. Can you imagine? No, sir. Like, respectful, but straight to the heart. He didn't even offer an excuse, like, hey, I got homework, or I'm hanging out with my friends, hey, sorry, can't do it. No excuse. The son simply refused to obey his father's command, and that is so disrespectful. It hurts. I've been there. We've all been there. But then he changed his mind and went to work. And then we could tell these in the story, the first son are these prostitutes, they're these tax collectors, they're the sinners. This is who he's representing here in verse 31 and 32. Some people reject Christ at first, then later change their minds and follow him. Then the father turned to his second son and instructed him to go work in the vineyard. What did the son say? I'll go, sir. But then he was polite, respectful, dutiful, and then he didn't go. I think that would hurt worse than anything. Like, you're out there working and you keep looking out the door, and then like your son doesn't come out to help you. And next thing you know, you're done with the project and you come in and be like, oh, sorry, got busy. So he had no intention. And then the second son, who is this? These are the religious leaders. They put on this outward show of obedience. They understand the law of Moses. They understand scripture, but they inwardly reject the word of God. They're just putting on a show. Some people seem to be following Christ, but are just inward rebellious at the whole time. They just put on a facade. They're going because that's what they should be doing instead of what they have to and must be doing. They shall be doing. We shall be obedient to God. We shall be going to church and being in a corporate worship with one another. And we should be in fellowship with one another. But the Pharisees had this plot, and they thought because they knew everything so well, they were above everybody else. And nobody else was perfect. They thought they could redeem their own salvation. As part of this parable, Jesus asked, which the two did will of his father? You notice, they always know how to sometimes answer the questions, right? What an obvious question. He forced them to answer, even though they probably realized the parable was directed right at them. You know, when somebody asks you a question, like I do interviews with people, most of the time when I ask them a question, because I'm doing an investigation, I already know the answer to the question. I'm just trying to get them to say it, right? I've done my research. I have reasonable suspicion or enough to go, I know the answer to this question. I'm going to ask it because I want them to state it, right? Jesus is getting these chief priests and these elders, maybe even the Pharisees, to answer the question out loud around other people, because there are probably always people around unless he's in that close comfort with his disciples. The first son was clearly obedient, even though at first he was rebellious and disrespectful and having no desire to do his will. And then Christ explained the short parable. He told the religious leaders that the tax collectors and prostitutes would enter the kingdom of God before them. They were the first son who ended up doing the will of the Father. Then he rebuked them for rejecting John's message and questioning his authority later in the verses. They're continuing to reject the word of God, and it's a continuous thing. God requires obedience and not this lip service. The Pharisees, the elders, they're just doing lip service. They're just going through the motions. God, people obey them. To obey, in 1 Samuel 15:22, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of the rams. There's a guy in there. And then you can see they didn't even change their minds after Jesus attacks them. You know, we keep on saying, just in the last parable, to forgive. We were talking about the forgiveness and loving your neighbor, but you notice Jesus was still confrontational and still loving. He's teaching and sharing the gospel with them, but he knows he has to, you know, stick the knife a little bit further in to maybe get some of these Pharisees and elders to change their mind. And we know through scripture, some of them have changed their minds and come towards him. But that was the two sons. Any questions before we transition?
The first son is a repentant heart. First son, like, he hears it, thinks about it for a while, then realizes.
Well, remember we talked about two paths. Like God sees us when we're talking about like the lost and found. In two of the three parables, Christ, you know, gave a demonstration of the woman looking for her silver and looking for the one sheep, right? And then the one story, the son rejected, wanted nothing to do with his family, and he came back on his own. So he already painted this picture to them, right? So some people are found because they have to be found, right? And some hear the Father's commands, hears their teaching, etc. He went out in the debauchery and decided to come back, right? Because God is still, the Holy Spirit is still working in his heart. So there's many paths, and this is what the Son is representing again in the short. Because he's already probably told this, attacked him with that at some point. He's already told those parables to them and their teachings. So there's different paths to God. You know.
Is he making reference to the heart?
Yeah. Hey, he said no, he was disrespectful, but he came to his senses. But his son, who paid lip service to the father, telling him what he's here, you know, just said said something and copycatted, and then was like, oh, I'm going to keep doing my own thing. It doesn't mean the second son will never come to Christ, but that's, we don't know the end of that story in this thing. He's just trying to represent. See, the first son is disrespectful. Prostitutes, the tax collectors, they did everything they weren't supposed to according to the law, but they're going to come in first because they listened to the message. They're not just paying lip service. They made a true transformation in their heart. The second son pretended like he did everything. Oh, hey, Dad. Probably had excuses for his father why he never came out, but he was just so far, far apart that sometimes things come at slower paces, and God controls the time, the will, the why, the when, the how. Those five W's, we don't know. Our job is to respond whenever we have, because we do not know the end time like Christ does, that God does. Any other questions?
I think that's a great picture you did, that think about the audience and how the Pharisees, you know, were of the Jewish religion, thought they were all good, but actually they weren't good at all. They weren't the ones, they were the ones who said, yeah, I'll go, but then they never went. There was never any real genuine faith there. But the other folks knew they were sinners, were messed up, didn't go at first, but then they went. And I think every time we read those kind of things, we ought to ask ourselves, who am I? And I think we would be lying to ourselves if we don't see a little bit of the Pharisee in ourselves as well, you know, to think about that. So we go away from the bad side, go to the good side. And it's like that favorite book I got, Pilgrim Progress. He said every one of those characters in that book that were messed up, he saw as himself at one point in time. And there were more messed up characters in that book than good ones right there. But I think that's a perfect point you brought out that setting, Jason. That's really good.
Where the audience and the challenge, these tax collectors and prostitutes probably thought they were, had no hope because these Pharisees, you know, demanded so much and they made it so legalistic that they just kept on sinning because they're like, I'm never going to be able to afford to pay my way through salvation or do all these works because of the life I'm handed. And when they heard the word of God firsthand, they're like, there is hope, there is a way. There is a path, and it's through Christ. It's such a beautiful thing. It's not through these Pharisees or these sacrificial burnings. They got it all wrong from the beginning. So, of course, they heard there's a new path. They wanting to come back, they just didn't know how to get there. They were those lost sheep. But the Pharisees are those other sons that knew everything, but yet they were further apart than the lost prostitutes or the lost sheep, because they knew what the scripture or what the word is teaching, and they didn't recognize it. But that's all I have. And
what's the five W's?
Oh, the five W's: who, what, when, where, and I don't know how
why.
How gets in
who,
there.
Who, what, why, where, when, and why.
But we always had how, why. How, why, yeah. The five W's, like, we think we know those to an aspect, but when it comes to end times or who's others saved, those questions are all, God knows those answers.
We need those five W's when we make a plan, Dale.
Yeah, yeah. What's the five W's? You'll get an email. No content. What's the five W's on this? You know, imagine God knows those five W's on everything and everybody. I might know because of a certain situation, but God knows everybody's five W's, and that's amazing. And the how.
Amen, amen.
He is the how and the why, right? All right, amen. We'll close. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the lessons, and thank you for your word. Thank you for your unmerited grace, your patience, your willingness for us, Lord. And thank you for your son that died for our sins, Lord. Pray for Pastor Buck at the sermon. Open up everybody's minds and ears and be with them, that his words are clear and concise, Lord. We ask this in your holy name.